Mortgage holders have been warned to brace themselves for the first interest rise in 12 years when the Reserve Bank meets later today. To explain the potential impacts, we're joined by finance and business expert Peter Switzer. Peter, it's a pleasure to have you here.
Pleasure to be here.
We've been hearing a lot about this. We've been getting worried. So are the tea leaves right? I mean, first off, I guess it's a two-parter. How much do we expect the interest rate to go up? More importantly, how is it going to hurt us?
OK, there's a remote chance that interest rates won't go up today. But if that happened, I think the Reserve Bank would probably increase by 0.4% in June once the election's out of the way. But the RBA governor is under pressure to deliver after that big inflation number last week, 5.1%, much bigger than they expected. So he's probably going to move with a 0.15% rise today.
What difference would that make to an average mortgage?
Yeah, I knew you'd ask that question, so thank God I was able to look it up. $600,000 loan, that's going to add about $47 to $50 a month in repayments. If you've got a $1 million loan, it's going to be around $80 extra a month.
A month, right.
Yeah. So remember, that's on 0.15.
The
scary bit is this there, Otto and Tristan. Bill Evans from Westpac is one of the best interest rate predictors in the country. He's the chief economist there. And he reckons there's going to be interest rate rises in 6 of the next 8 months, which will take the cash rate, which is 0.1, to 1.5. Now, I reckon that's over the top. Bill's been right a lot. I think the Reserve Bank might take it to 1%. Still, that's going to be a pretty big rise for lots of people who've maybe overborrowed unbelievably low interest rates.
And that will be hundreds of dollars a month.
In
extra payments.
Yeah.
Peter, usually the Reserve Bank will increase interest rates to slow the economy down.
Yeah.
But in this case, inflation is rising for the same factors that economies would usually be going gangbusters. There are supply shortages. Are they different circumstances here?
Yeah, it's a great question. In fact, I read something today which I actually wrote on my website, switzer.com.au, just in case you missed it.
No.
And Ross Gittin said exactly the same thing as well, that inflation can be made of two parts. Massive demand, which you're kind of talking about, a booming gangbusters economy. Everyone's really hyper-confident. They're spending a lot of money. OK, raise interest rates and you slow it down to reduce the inflation. But this inflation is being driven by costs. Costs because China's in lockdown. Lots of the stuff we normally would have in, say, cars. Microchips, you can't get them. That's why we can't get cars at the moment. And the price of cars have gone up as a consequence. That's cost. You've got Ukraine war, which has pushed oil prices through the roof and has pumped up the petrol price. All those things have gone in, and therefore the cost of living's going up. So the question is, why do you add to the cost of living by raising interest rates? And the answer is, well, you do it just to hit the bit of demand that's there, because there are a lot of people who are doing really well. They have had wage rises. Their businesses have done pretty well. JobKeeper actually helped them. And there are, if you go talk to travel agents right now, you can't get a seat business class anywhere out of this country because they've all been sold by people who are doing well. So a part of the interest rate rise will help slow those people down, but other people who are really finding it hard will find it tough, without a doubt.
Yeah. And for the people then who might have a mortgage right now, is it too late now to kind of try and get a fixed interest rate?
No, it's not. It's not too late. See, look, if you're a really good researcher and you've gone on the online websites and you've got yourself, there are 1 year rates still under 2%. But I've met people who've got 3.5% home loans, which means that they haven't been a mortgage broker, they haven't twisted the arm of their bank, or they haven't gone online to try and bring their rates down. It's not too late. And I would go online, try and get it online, particularly if you've got a really good job and you're really secure. A lot of lenders will get you to refinance, and mortgage brokers will help you do it because they get the money by helping you get into it as well. And they don't benefit from you. They benefit from the lender who pays them for doing it. So it's not too late, but I think a lot of people have probably left it.
I think the problem is being sometimes, like, you might have that job when you get the loan and then the job's gone. And I guess we've been trying to make sense of this home equity plan that's coming up, the policy that's being suggested, and we can't make head or tail of it yet. And again, it might be my own ignorance, but I need someone to explain it to me.
And
maybe you can if it's a good idea or if it's...
Well, look, put it this way. In principle, it will help a lot of people get into the home loan market. And the idea is, rather than someone borrowing 100% of what they need to get a loan, they'll borrow 60% and the government will put the other 40% in. But then the government is then a 4/10 owner of the property. So as capital gain happens, and that's what happens in this country. By the way, Sydney's house prices actually went sideways for 10 years. They don't always rise, but then, of course, that, it made up for the last few years where it's just gone ballistic. So Albo, in coming up with this policy, is probably betting on the fact that Australian property prices will keep rising, and therefore they will be, the taxpayer will be beneficiaries over a longer period of time. But if there's a recession and people can't make their payments, there's a divorce or something like that, and a place has to be sold. But well, the thing is, if it's sold, any gain will be shared between the government and the owner. Yeah. If there's any loss, well, the owner will walk away from it because they don't chase them for that.
Something kind of thing. Scott Morrison is walking away from is the politics of this.
Yeah.
He's saying that politics isn't involved in the Reserve Bank's decision, but he has created an economy and a situation where we have been seeing inflation through the roof, and the Reserve Bank is now having to act. And for a government that is standing on their financial credentials.
Yeah.
There's a bit of politics in there, isn't there?
Yeah, without a doubt. But look, I've got to say this. JobKeeper and all that sort of stuff save a hell of a lot of jobs. It costs the government an enormous amount of money, and the budget deficit's really massive because of it. And these sort of things are happening now. Interest rates at, 0.1%, borrowing at 2%. These are extraordinary things to deal with, an extraordinary thing that I'm a person who lectured economics at the University of New South Wales. I never taught or learnt pandemics 101.
Okay.
So we're all kind of learning on the job with this kind of thing. And the bottom line is this, if you look at the implications of all this, we dodged a Great Depression. And Treasury was thinking that unemployment in this country would go to 15% before they came up with JobKeeper. And by the way, Scott Morrison and Treasurer Josh Frydenberg were more like Labor prime ministers and treasurers when they did that, because that's what exactly a Labor government would have done. They would have spent to keep people in jobs. Mm. Old-fashioned coalition governments would never have done that. There was, the market can solve this problem. No, the market was never going to solve that problem.
Oh, Peter, thank you so much for explaining all of those things.
Yeah, we needed it. I appreciate it. Thanks for joining us today, Peter Switzer. I appreciate
it. Great pleasure.
Okay.